Everyone, welcome to Analog VLSI Design course. This is lecture number 1.1 particularly. And today we are going to discuss the course prerequisite, examination scheme, and the syllabus. So let us start with, you know, the very outset of AVLSI, Analog VLSI Design, short form we call it AVLSI. So number one point will be that we will be analyzing and designing various circuits, analog circuits, which we use in a VLSI, very large-scale integrated circuits. And every lecture session, it's a request to keep a calculator in handy and keep a pen and writing pad or a book in handy with you, because it's exhaustively involved, analytical thinking. That means we will be analyzing, we will be discussing concepts, and we will be designing also. So the course will cover numericals. There will be plenty of numericals and derivations to understand those concepts. Okay, so one more feature I've added, I put boxes over here, and whichever is the first part, I've written one over here. So that's easier for you to navigate. Now, for the course prerequisite, how this subject has been built up is as follows. In your lower semesters, you must have studied basic electronic circuits. In that majority, you have studied semiconductor device physics, and out of that, all the devices which you have studied, the most important was MOSFET, metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. Then in semester number four came electronic circuit analysis and design, short form ECAD. There we have studied the very important concept which I have written over here in green, amplifier concept. So we have some background of some amplifiers. And we have already seen single stage and differential amplifiers before, right? So those concepts, we will be utilizing them. Then came in semester number five, linear integrated circuit design, that is LICD. In that we have extensively studied op-amp circuits. So over here, whatever I marked in red, we will be using in they are going to be, again going to be taught in this subject in perspective of analog VLSI design. So we'll be discussing the transistor level implementation of op-amps. Okay, op-amp we have seen in form of an IC, 741 IC. But now we are going to design that using transistors. So that is what we are going to do. And then in semester number six, we have studied basics of VLSI design, wherein it focused on CMOS circuit. We can put in the domain of digital CMOS circuit. So if you want me to compare BVLSI and AVLSI, BVLSI was more of a digital, CMOS circuits. And in case of AVLSI, it is more on the analog side. Fine. So this is my second point. Third is just a mere information for you all. Course code is given. Course title is Analog VLSI Design. We have 3 hours per week lectures. Then in the continuous assessment, we have IA component of 20 marks. Well, the IA, ISE syllabus, everything has been uploaded in MS Teams, so you can check on that. And end semester exam, we have 50. Next is the very important syllabus, AVLSI design syllabus. So I will like to take 5 minutes and discuss about that, because the flow is also very, very important. And the very first thing which you notice by looking at this part is what? Module number 1 and 2, if you combine the number of hours, is 24. Okay? And rest all the modules, if we combine, it's even lesser than that. So that means module number 1 and 2 covers around 50% of the syllabus. Whereas module number 3, 4 and 5 combined around less than 50% of the syllabus. Okay? So here we will start with CMOS analog building blocks. So module number 1.1 will be like a revision to you. We have already concentrated on MOSFET models in the lower semesters, but here we will have one more additional component in it. We will review the MOSFET characteristics today, and why we study analog design, or why it is so important, that we will study in tomorrow's class. Then we'll go to MOSFET small signal model and MOSFET SPICE model, which you have already familiar with. Then in the continuity, we will not cover 1.2 and 1.3. We will directly after 1.1 jump to 2.1, okay, for continuity basis. So we'll study single stage amplifiers. Basically, you might have heard of common source, common drain and common gate stages in ECAD, right? We have studied single stage amplifiers and we have done the analysis. But this time we'll be doing the same, but slightly differently. There we used resistor biasing, meaning in one single amplifier, you require a lot of resistors. Okay, voltage divided biasing, how many resistors you require? R1, R2, RE, RC, four resistors we require. But in integrated circuits, we don't use resistors because of the obvious reasons. We will discuss them. And also we will be discussing cascode. We have discussed cascode amplifier in the lower semester, but this will be slightly different. We will be not be using resistors. I mean, we cannot completely avoid, but first we will start with the resistive load and then we'll see why don't we use that and what are the limitations. And then we have also done this frequency response analysis of the single stage amplifier in your lower semesters. We will be doing that. So after 2.1, basically 2.2 normally, let's see how much syllabus we complete. After 1.1, we'll complete 2.1 and then we'll jump to 1.2 and then 1.3. So the sequence over here will be module number 1.1, module number 2.1, module number 1.2, and then module number 1.3. So this will be your ISC syllabus also. You can check it out. This is your ISC syllabus. Module number 1 and module number 2.1. Okay, so that will cover roughly around half of the syllabus. Well, if we get sufficient time, we'll also cover frequency response, or else depending upon the status of the syllabus, we can mostly keep it as a self-study. We will decide it later on how much we have. We'll cover it later because it's just the extension of concepts which we have learned earlier. So we'll decide on that. 2.2, we'll keep it on hold. And then from module number 3, we'll start with differential amplifiers. I don't remember if y'all had differential amplifiers in a syllabus for ECAD. Y'all had it? Differential amplifiers? Single-ended and differential operation, common mode, and all that thing we had. So those were again using excessively resistors. So here we'll be using the active devices as MOS devices. Okay. So all this differential amplifier is devoted to module number 3. And then comes the MOS operational amplifier. Now op-amp design, you have, as I've told you, you have studied with respect to 741 IC. It was already an IC available. But this time we are going to design op-amps using MOSFETs. Okay, keeping in mind the various performance parameters of the op-amp also. And then finally, we will move on to the analog layout and other concepts, wherein we will be, digital layout and analog layout are two different strategies. Rules for digital layouts are always there, and they are different from foundry to foundry. Foundries are the ones who makes manufacturers chips. So those rules for digital, layouts are very, very standard, and it's a very standard procedure. But analog layout require a different, level of understanding and knowledge. So there are various concepts in analog layout techniques, which we'll be discussing in module number 5. Okay. Now let's move on to the reference books. So there are 4 reference books. Reference number, book number 1, Razavi, Behzad Razavi, title author, book title is Design of Analog CMOS Integrated Circuits. This is the major book. Most of the contents are taken from, Razavi book over here. Fine. So reference book number 3. So reference book number 3, Allen and Hallberg, will be using it for the design of two-stage op-amp. So I'll be referring this for two-stage op-amp design and reference book number 1, that is Design of Analog CMOS Integrated Circuits by Razavi sir. We'll be explicitly using for the entire semester, the entire subject. Now, let's look into the outline of the course. So the outline of the course, we'll be learning this major concepts. First, we'll be discussing MOSFET models and its characteristics. Then second will be, see the name over here, single stage integrated MOSFET amplifiers. What you have studied in your lower semesters or in LICD or ECAD is single stage discrete MOSFET amplifiers, okay, where a MOSFET was an IC and external resistors have to be connected. But here we are talking about integrated circuits, So inside your mobile phones, inside your laptops, all are integrated circuits. They are not discrete. They are integrated in a single silicon substrate. Okay. So we'll be discussing single stage and analyzing and designing single stage integrated MOSFET amplifiers. Okay. Third important concept will be outcome will be current mirrors. Current mirrors are extremely important because we are no longer, you know, using the resistors for biasing. We are using MOSFETs only for biasing. So current mirrors are very, very important concept. Also, differential amplifiers. We know the importance of differential amplifier. It rejects noise and amplifies the difference between the two input signals. That's very useful for biomedical applications or applications where the difference between the very small input signals are to be amplified. And then we'll be studying integrated MOSFET op-amp. Okay, I hope you have understood what do you mean by integrated MOSFET op-amp. We have studied op-amp with 741, but this time we'll be using MOSFETs to build an op-amp circuit. And then finally, analog layout techniques. So this will be my outline of this course. Any questions for this? Shall we move into the next one?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. So now, for your information, there will be a quiz before we end this today's session. So, you know, concentrate on these concepts which I'm discussing over here. This is about MOSFET device and characteristics. This is just a revision for you all. But I want to revise it once. So I thought, let's not. This you have already, most of you might be knowing it, but let me revise it once, MOSFET, because it's very, very important device. So here you see a cross-sectional view of a, like we can say in a layman's language, a two-dimensional structure for a MOSFET, N-channel MOSFET. So N-channel MOSFET has a P-silicon substrate, okay? And in this P-silicon substrate, we have, you know, we can have adjacent MOSFETs to the right-hand side or left-hand side. We have many, many devices together. So integrated circuit means on a single chip, you manufacture a lot of devices. Okay, so here it is, here a cross-sectional view of a single MOSFET. Here there is a lot of information given. It's actually a slide from a video which I've taken before. And yeah, let me briefly tell you about the various, important things. So there are two N plus source and drain regions marked in green color over here. Then we have a P silicon substrate. Then we have this blue color, light blue color is my oxide layer, SiO2 layer. And my pink color is my metal layer, okay? So it has four terminals, MOSFET has four terminals, drain, gate, source, and body. Now listen very, very carefully, this is very, very important. The body of the MOSFET is the substrate itself, okay? The body of the MOSFET is substrate itself, and substrate is normally connected to ground. Very carefully listen, substrate is normally connected to the ground of a chip. But source terminal might not be always connected to the ground. Okay, so I mean to say this difference between the potential between the source and the body might not be always equal to zero. Okay, that will also greatly influence the working of my MOSFET. Now this information I'm giving in addition to what you know. Fine, so be very, very careful. And then there are two electric fields. The electric field in the vertical direction is marked in yellow arrow. Over here, EY, and our electric field in the horizontal direction is marked as orange here over here. Here I marked in green and pink color, EX and EY. And normally your lateral electric field is greater than your vertical electric field. I mean, EX is greater than EY. That's what defines the moment of current flow. So how will the current flow? Current will flow in the horizontal direction or in the vertical direction? Yeah,
horizontal direction.
Yes, current will always flow in the horizontal direction. What is EY doing? EY is pulling up the electrons, minority carrier electrons from the P silicon substrate and attracting it towards the SiO2 interface so that it will form a channel. And once the channel is formed, and once you apply external voltage across the drain and source and the gate and source, then the currents, then the electrons over here, as you can see, electrons have showed by a dot. Electrons from the N source region will be traveling through the channel, which is marked in orange color, and reaching to the drain terminal. Okay, so your current will be, electrons will be flowing from source to drain, whereas your conventional current will be going from drain to source. So this additional information, I mean, this information we already know. And one more thing is that we have a PN junction actually inside it. So P silicon substrate and N plus source region, P silicon substrate and N plus drain region are actually reverse bias. Okay, because you are applying a positive voltage to the drain terminal, which will make this junction reverse bias. Yeah, so that is the information over here, which I wanted to share. Then let me go over here. Yeah, can anyone tell me why input impedance in a MOSFET is very, very high?
SiO2 layer.
Yes, SiO2 layer. Because of the presence of SiO2 layer, there is no gate current. There is no possibility of gate current. In reality, the gate current will be in picoamperes, very, very, very small. Okay, will be very, very small. So for all practical purpose, we consider IG to be zero. That's the reason why the input impedance of MOSFET is very, very high. That means in a MOSFET, we have no input characteristics. There is no IG versus VGS characteristics we have. So that is very, very important information which you should know. And then, you know, under the influence of electric field, how does the current flow? Here I have described over here. Electric field is given by voltage divided by length. Okay, so why is the electric field powerful? Because the application of voltages are very, very small. As you have studied in the scaling technique in VVLSI, the device dimensions are reducing. Also, the voltages, external voltages are reducing. So nowadays in 100 nanometer technology, the voltage have reached around 1.8 volts and the length of the channel is reached around 100 nanometers. So you can see the electric fields have become very, very powerful. The unit of electric field is volt per centimeter. So here also inside the MOSFET also we have electric field. For convenience, I'm only showing EX because EY job is just to collect, make the N channel between the N plus source and the drain region. For the current to flow, we have to apply a voltage across the drain and the source and the gate and the source. Okay, now when will the channel form? Do you know the condition when for the channel to be formed? These are the basics. What is the condition, voltage condition for the channel to be formed for the N-channel MOSFET, enhancement MOSFET?
VGS greater than the threshold voltage.
Perfect, very good. So we have to keep your gate to source voltage greater than your threshold voltage VTO for the channel to be formed. Now, once the channel is formed, will my current flow or I have to apply another voltage? If I just keep VGS greater than VTO, will the current flow?
No.
No.
No. The reason being is VGS greater than VTO will pull the minority carry electrons and it will make the N channel. But for the N channel, for the current to flow, we have to apply a voltage to the drain terminal with respect to source. Then the carriers from the drain terminal, from the source terminal, will be traveling via the channel and moves towards the drain terminal. And then we say the device constitutes current. Okay, and that is with the help of this EX electric field. So here I have shown the concept of that. Remember over here, the body terminal or the substrate terminal, or it is also called as a bulk terminal, is connected to ground. Mostly it is connected to ground, but the source terminal, it's not guaranteed it's connected to ground. Okay, if it is not connected to ground, we have a potential difference between the body and or the bulk region and the source region. Okay, this is just the structure for a P-channel MOSFET. For a P-channel MOSFET, the substrate is N-silicon and we have two P-silicon materials. Okay, remember the threshold voltage. Very, very important concept. It has different notations. It is also denoted as VTO, VTH or VTN. Fine. Now let us discuss briefly the applications of MOSFET. So MOSFET, as you all know, it's a unipolar device. It's a voltage control device. Which voltage is controlling which current? Anyone wants to say? Why it is called as a voltage control device?
Because MOSFET requires a voltage input.
Yes, actually your voltage between the gate and the source is controlling the current at the output terminal, that is the drain terminal. So that's why it's a voltage control device. Your VGS will control the ID, or ID is being controlled by VGS. And MOSFET are of two types, enhancement and depletion. So enhancement MOSFETs are called as normally off. Depletion MOSFETs are called as normally on. What is the reason for that is, in enhancement type MOSFET, the channel is not formed. Okay, the channel over here is formed by the application of voltage. Whereas in depletion type of MOSFET, the channel is already present. Okay, so as soon as you apply some voltages, you are turning off the device by application of voltage in depletion MOSFET. And in enhancement MOSFET, by application of external voltage, you are turning on the device. And explicitly for the entire discussion of most of the modules, we'll be focusing on the enhancement type MOSFETs. Okay, now it's also a nonlinear device. We know it because of its characteristics. What are the various applications? Here I've written over here somewhere. Yeah, preferred MOSFET enhancement devices. Now, the applications of the MOSFETs are as follows. It can be used as an electronically controlled switch. Okay, and in the operating regions, it should operate as a cutoff or triode region, off or on. It can be used as an amplifier. Now we will be using it as an amplifier. Analog domain means it can be used as an amplifier, right? So MOSFET as an amplifier, it works. It has to work in the saturation region for it to work as an amplifier. Then it can be used as an electronically controlled switch. Very, very important. Because we said resistors are not used, not preferred in your integrated circuits. That means we cannot connect a resistor. Fine. So we can use MOSFET as resistors. So this is another application of a MOSFET, electronically controlled switch, or it should operate in the triode region for it. And then memories. Well, we have discussed this last semester. It can use as a storage devices as a MOSCAP also. Fine. This is also important. You should know their symbols. Now, this is the NMOS enhancement and PMOS enhancement, NMOS depletion and PMOS depletion. You can know the difference in the symbol over here. Here, there is a channel already present, indicated like this over here. And here, this channel over here is broken, indicating that the channel is not yet formed. So, can you say which is a digital symbol and which is an analog symbol? I call this as this one, the four terminal symbol over here and the three terminal symbol. So can you tell me which is the digital and analog symbol?
So the four terminal is an analog symbol.
Yes, the four terminal is an analog symbol and the three terminal is a digital symbol. The difference between analog and digital is this. We will be discussing that briefly. But in digital, we are only concerned with the MOSFET whenever it turns on and turns off. Okay. Whereas in case of analog, we are concerned with if the MOSFET is on, in which region it is operating. That also we should know. Okay. And whereas in digital, if it is on, we are not concerned about which operating region it is. It has to be either on or off. Only two states. Wherein in digital, we have two states between logic 0 and logic 1. That's it. We have to take care of the noise margin level. Fine. But in case of analog, you have to worry about everything. Entire, you can have, MOSFET operating in, you have seen the VTC curve, right? In any point of that VTC curve. So we have to be very, very careful in analog domain. So, be careful about the symbols also. If you want, you can take a print screen of this. Okay, let's move ahead. Now let's come to the operating conditions. So MOSFET can act in the cutoff region. The form and the condition is given and the current formula is given. So VGS has to be less than VTO. The current will be zero. In reality, it is not zero. It is called as your sub-threshold conduction, which we are not going to discuss, which is beyond the scope of the syllabus. But I'm just informing you all, even if VGS is less than VTO, still the current flows, and that current is very, very small. But for all practical purposes, we are believing it to be zero over here. Then we have a linear or a triode region. Now you will say, why I'm using the word triode? When we say in the linear region, we will come back to it when the characteristics. Now from now on, we will use the word triode region. So what are the two conditions? VGS has to be greater than VTO, and VDS has to be less than VGS minus VTO. We call it ID linear. And saturation operating region is, condition will be, VGS should be greater than VTO, and VDS will be greater than or equal to VGS minus VTO. That will be ID saturation. Then we have MOSFET device characteristics. Well, not much to discuss over here. We all know about it. I'll be just discussing about the important points. Okay. So transfer characteristics is between VGS and ID. Okay. So if VGS is less than VTO, the device is in cutoff. After that, can anyone knows in which operating region does the device goes after cutoff once VGS is greater than VTO? Anyone aware of it? This green color curve, which I'm marking over here, after cutoff, if VGS is greater than VTO, which region does the device go?
Saturation.
Yes, it goes in saturation, and to your surprise, after a higher voltage of VGS, it even goes into triode region. Okay, it goes into saturation initially, and then it goes into triode region. And let's concentrate, and in this operating region, saturation region, the current is given by a very famous equation, which you have used it many times. ID is equal to KN into VGS minus VTO, the whole square. Now, this is probably the last time we will be writing KN. We'll be writing all the formulas in terms of this. Mu n Cox by 2 W by L, where mu n Cox is also written as KN dash, okay? Where mu n is the mobility of electrons, Cox is the gate oxide capacitance, and the unit of Kn is milliampere per volt square. I told you we are using this for the very last time. We'll be writing this drain current formula in terms of this device dimensions, gate oxide capacitance, and the mobility of electrons. Fine? So this is the formula for NMOS enhancement type MOSFET. Now in the output characteristics, we can show the cutoff region where we can, it is normally a curve on the x-axis. So for increasing values of VGS, we are getting a enhanced current, drain current flow. So we say that your, the VGS controls the ID value. ID has been controlled by VGS, okay? So there are three operating modes cutoff. Here is the triode region. Here you see triode region over here. There we have a family of locus of curves, VGS minus VT. So on the left-hand side, we have the linear or the triode region. Earlier, we called it linear. It is, the graph is linear for very small values of VDS, but for higher values, it becomes non-linear. That's why we are not calling it as a linear now. We'll be calling it as a triode region now. In the lower semester, you might have called linear, but now we will be calling it as a triode region. And then everyone knows saturation. Saturation is the region where your ID loses control over VDS. Meaning, even if you increase VDS, your ID will remain constant. ID will only be, disturbed by VGS only. That's it. As you can see, the green level, the blue level, the pink level, blue level, and the green level. What's the difference between the three? The increase in the VGS level, okay, the VGS voltage. So, ID is controlled heavily by VGS, loosely by VDS. And we know practically it slightly increases. We know it's not a constant. So in the saturation region, MOSFET can act as a current source. It can also act as an amplifier. Any questions based on the MOSFET device characteristics, anyone?
No, sir.
Okay, thank you. We'll move ahead to the last part of the lecture. Here I am marked in enhanced mode. I'm in a little bigger diagram. We call this triode region also as non-saturation from now on. Okay, non-saturation, we will drop the word linear henceforth. We'll be only using triode or non-saturation. We have three operating regions, cutoff, saturation, and triode region. That's it. So concentrate on it. Now, in your LICD and ECAD and BEC, you have studied discrete circuits. Okay, you have studied MOSFET-based discrete amplifiers. You have studied MOSFET-based, or BJT-based differential amplifier, which were discrete circuits. Discrete circuit means what? Which you can fit inside the breadboard, which uses resistive biasing. Okay, so your circuits in BEC, ECAD, LICD all use resistive biasing extensively. If you recollect, if you try to recollect any amplifier circuit, minimum four resistors is uses. Okay, also it uses capacitors. Any amplifier, you take an amplifier, a single stage amplifier, multi-stage amplifier, you can imagine so many resistors and so many capacitors it has used. Okay, those were discrete circuits. Now, in this subject, that is your analog VLSI, we will be designing or studying integrated circuits. For integrated circuits, we don't use passive elements, R and C. We avoid to use them. We cannot say we completely avoid them. Very rarely we use them. So the capacitor and a resistor, they are replaced by MOSFET. So this is the concept and the difference between your BEC, ECAD and analog VLSI. In analog VLSI, we will be designing the circuits without any resistor. I mean, in one step further, I can say we will be, studying circuits which are without any resistors. That means MOSFET will act as resistors. We just saw MOSFET can be used as an electronically controlled switch. So we'll be doing that only. Okay. So why I'm discussing this again is we are going to obtain certain parameters from the output characteristics. Okay. So there is an internal output resistance of the MOSFET, which is biased in the saturation region. You might have heard of this term, RO or RD. In the small signal model, you might have studied. So what it is, in the saturation region, when the current is almost constant, in fact, it is not almost constant, it is slightly increased. Which phenomena will be, describing this behavior? Anyone? In the BVLSI, we have discussed a phenomena which explains the increase in the current in the saturation region. Anyone remembers? Channel length modulation. You must have heard of this term, right? So channel length modulation means lambda. Okay, lambda was non-zero over here. So the slope of this I delta ID upon delta VDS, okay, 1 upon slope will be my resistance, RO. And ideally, if the current doesn't increase, the RO will be infinite. And practically, it's a very large value. This is very, very important concept. This RO is the small signal output resistance of a MOSFET biased in the saturation region. So if you want to take a print screen, you can, or you note it down somewhere. The RO formula is delta VDS upon delta ID at constant VGS value. And practically, it's a very large value. And when I say large value, it will be nearby greater than 10 kilo ohms. This I have written 50 kilo ohms, but it's even greater than 10 kilo ohms, 20 kilo ohms, something in this range also it comes. Okay, note it down. Fine. Then there is one more resistance. Now, this is my on state resistance. This is something new. On state resistance of a MOSFET biased in the triode region. Okay, what's the difference between this? This is my resistance of a current source. RO, if I want to operate my MOSFET as a constant current source, this RO is the internal resistance of that current source. Okay, so we have found out this is my output resistance of the MOSFET. This is also a resistance of the MOSFET, but a on state resistance of the MOSFET. So remember, MOSFET, when it is in the triode region, it's almost depicting a linear behavior. Okay, so in this small region also, we can determine that a MOSFET can act as a resistor. And the resistance, that resistance is called as on-state resistance of the MOSFET. This is the new concept, now remember carefully. So we are on, how do we measure? Delta VDS upon delta ID, actually 1 upon slope. Slope will be delta ID, slope will be y2 minus y1 upon x2 minus x1. That will be delta ID, changes in ID, upon changes in VDS. So R on will be 1 upon slope. So here, as you can see, there is not much change in VDS. The value of R on will be very, very low. And it's obvious also, right? As we know, the current is very small. So the resistance will be inversely proportional to the current, right? So here it will be very, very small value, R on, because the changes in ID is very small. Change in VDS is also very, very small. So R on value is a low value, few ohms, not even in kilo ohms, few tens of ohms or hundreds of ohms, that's it. So remember, R on is the on state resistance of a MOSFET biased in the triode region. Have you noted it down? Or you take a print screen of this. This is the new concept. R on. On state resistance of MOSFET biased in the triode region. Okay, let me move on to the last one. Parameters from transfer curve, we have GM. Now this is fairly simple. Here, this is an exponential curve, but there is a small segment in this exponential curve which will be a linear, which will be almost a straight line. So if you draw a tangent, you will get a straight line over here, and the variations, that is delta ID upon delta VGS, will give GM. And what is GM? GM is the MOSFET transconductance. Okay, it is a transfer of conductance. Conductance, resistance opposite is conductance, right? So resistance is voltage upon current, conductance will be current upon voltage. And why it is called as transconductance? Because here the voltage is input and the current is output. Okay, so you're transferring your voltage at the input to a current at the output. So basically it's a V2I converter. If you see carefully, MOSFET is a V2I converter. It's converting a voltage into a current. So GM is my delta ID upon delta VGS. Remember the unit, it's milliampere per volt. Fine, you can take a print screen of this also and keep it steady with you. So these are the parameters, small RO, capital R on, which is on state resistance of the MOSFET, and GM. These parameters are very, very crucial in the analysis of MOSFET circuits, which we are going to analyze. And at the last, at the outset, in the saturation region, mostly VGS controls ID. Why I write VGS controls ID? Because ID is loosely dependent upon VDS. It rarely changes the value. Then VGS controls over ID is very limited. That's what we have written. ID is almost constant. And in the saturation region, MOSFET behaves as a constant current source. In fact, we can write one more point. It can behave also as a amplifier in the saturation region. So this is all about the basics of MOSFET, which were required.